Hurricane Beryl making its presence felt on the Cayman Islands. The Category 3 storm is just off the Caymans, but you can see it's already bringing pretty powerful winds, very heavy rains. People in Jamaica are getting their first good look at the damage, mostly from the winds and the flooding. Beryl brought more than 2 months' worth of rain to the area in a single day. It's killed 8 people in its rampage through the Caribbean. CNN's Rafael Romo was in the storm as it was bearing down on Jamaica on Wednesday, and he gave us a very vivid report.
Hurricane Beryl is now here in Jamaica, and it's hitting the southern tip of the coastline with all its might. It's hard to remain standing because the winds are just very, very powerful. And this is not over yet. We have seen how lots of debris have been blown off in the last few minutes, and also how the roof was blown off on top of that building right there. And the big danger is that there's a possibility of the ocean getting into the street, because the storm surge is supposed to rise at least 10 feet. So these are very dangerous conditions here in Kingston. And of course, authorities are asking people to remain in shelters. They tell us that nearly 500 people are in shelters right now. Again, this is only the beginning, and you can tell how strong the winds are here in Kingston, Jamaica. And people are wondering here, why is this happening so early in the season? And after seeing what happened in Barbados and places like Grenada, they feel like it's possible that the same devastation seen there can be seen here as well. Rafael Romo, CNN, Kingston, Jamaica.
Well, meteorologist Elisa Raffa is in the CNN Weather Center in Atlanta with more on where the hurricane is going. It does seem to have died down, but presumably it can pick up again at some point.
Yes, it has been slowly, slightly weakening as it runs into some ingredients like wind upstairs in the atmosphere that is trying to disorganize it. But it is still able to maintain major Category 3 strength. We're still talking about winds up to 120 miles per hour as it's bringing some tropical storm force conditions to the Cayman Islands, some flash flooding from some intense rain already. They've had gusts upwards of 55 miles per hour in the Cayman Islands this morning. Gusts right now are over 40 miles per hour. The Cayman Islands getting the brunt of this right now. Here are some of these ingredients that I was talking about. The wind shear upstairs in the atmosphere that is allowing the intensity to come down some, especially as it heads towards Mexico. But it will maintain that hurricane strength as it heads towards the Yucatan Peninsula. You're looking at it making landfall somewhere maybe near Cancun, Cozumel, or anywhere down towards Belize. And we're looking at storm surge up to 4 to 6 feet. That's 2 meters of storm surge, plus all of that heavy rain. And then it will head back into the Gulf of Mexico, where these waters here are very warm, and it could maybe briefly intensify again. Rain totals again across the Yucatan Peninsula, we're looking at some 4 to 6 inches, maybe even up to 10 inches in some high elevations. That could cause some flash flooding as we go through the day tomorrow. It maintains hurricane strength. That's why we have hurricane warnings in effect for parts of Mexico there. Then this is what I was talking about. Gets back into the Gulf of Mexico. It might be able to intensify into a hurricane again before it sets its eyes on somewhere between the Mexico and Texas border there in the U.S. where it can make that additional landfall. So something that we'll have to watch very closely when it comes to rain, rip currents, and storm surge right there along the coast of Mexico and Texas. It depends on how intense this area of high pressure is on if it takes that trek a little bit farther north into the U.S. Max.
Okay, thank you so much for that. We'll be watching closely. The Prime Minister of Jamaica, Andrew Holness, now with us. He joins us from Kingston. Thank you so much for sparing the time today. I know you've got a huge amount to do. Can you give us a sense of the damage that was done overnight?
Well, we're still in assessment mode. What we can say is that based upon the category of hurricane that hit us at a category 4, the damage was not what we had expected. And so we're very grateful for that. But there was damage nonetheless. We had damage to some coastal infrastructure in southern parishes. We had damage to agriculture and housing in 2 parishes, Manchester and St. Elizabeth. We have had some roads cut off and blocked. But outside of that, I think Jamaica was spared the worst.
Are all of your people on the ground able to contact everyone? Is everyone accounted for?
Everyone is accounted for. We had two deaths so far registered. We have now about 1,000 persons in shelters. Our telecommunication systems are, I would say, 70% operational. Electricity went down in some areas. We are restoring that as quickly as we can. We are now into recovery phase, so we are doing our assessments, and in another 2 or 3 hours, we'll be able to give a full assessment as to what the damage is.
I know yesterday you were speaking about law and order, because this does sadly become an issue, doesn't it, when people have to evacuate their homes, possible looting. Are there any signs of that happening overnight?
Thankfully, because of the extensive preparedness campaign in which we engaged, we were able to mitigate any such activities. So we have no reports of looting or any breakdown in public order. So in general, we are in a very good state to start our recovery.
Have you spoken strongly in the past about your concerns about climate change? Because you not only sit on an earthquake fault line, you're also increasingly seeing storms, aren't you? And do you think there was an illustration of that here?
Well, this is a perfect example of climate change. If there are any doubts as to climate change, well, this should certainly dismiss any doubts. This hurricane happened very early in the season, reached a Category 5, the first hurricane to reach a Category 5 so early. It went through the Caribbean, caused damage to our sister islands in the Eastern Caribbean, and it caused damage to us, which we are now assessing. The impact of this is not just on our infrastructure, but on our fiscal affairs. We have made significant changes to our fiscal management to be able to deal with high frequency, low severity weather events. But what we're seeing happening are events that we would formally say that they are low frequency but high severity. We're seeing that these weather events are happening with greater frequency, at least one every 2 or 3 years. The impact on a small open economy and our budget and our exposure to debt is quite significant. So the issues of climate change and the climate justice issues are significant for us in the developing world.
These are issues that your head of state, King Charles, has spoken to widely. I've had a note from him expressing his heartfelt condolences to those who've lost people across the Caribbean because of this storm. And he says he's hoping to engage with regional leaders directly in the coming days to offer support. Is that something you welcome?
Yes, I expect to have a call with King Charles. He has been a great campaigner on the issues of climate change and raising awareness. And I hope to engage with him so that we can advance the climate change agenda globally.
OK, Prime Minister, really appreciate your time. I'll let you get back to work. Thank you so much.
You.
And I'm glad it wasn't as bad as you had feared.